Hello, everybody. I'm Romain. I work on the Hue project at Cloudera. And today, I'm going to present how we built a cool UI for Solar. And hopefully, we'll give you an idea if you want to also build a similar UI or also just use like this UI. So the biggest goal of this talk is really, I don't know how familiar you are with web development. If everybody knows a little bit in the room already, just to gauge like the how people knows a little bit, I guess. And so I will show how we built Hue, how Solar is really magic to pull some data, build some facettings, and explore your data, especially if you are a beginner and you don't want to know what's inside your collection. Everything is based on the regular standard API. So to configure Hue, you just need to put like the address of the Solar host. It's a bit similar as the Solar UI, so that's it. There is no custom code. We just pull from the real API. It means also if you have already your Solar setup, you can just point Hue to it and already use the UI. A bit of history. So last year, we started to build the UI. We had already like some highlighting. You could define a few facets. You could like, this is an example of Twitter search. It was pretty nice, but it was a bit ugly. Like the timeline, it looked like a little bit like mushrooms. It was like year 2005. For a web app. If you have a generic Solar collection, it's also more difficult to have a generic UI for any type of Solar collection. So this was the admin part. So you could enter custom HTML, which was a problem because not everybody knows HTML. And to put some facets, you had to put like verbatim, like the Solar syntax, like if you had to do like a range on a date. You had to put now like hours. And to see the change, like on this user UI, you had to save the previous one, meaning if you had done a mistake, like put hours with a Z instead of hours for a facet, it would break your page. So it was not interactive at all. So we had to, like we think a bit, and then we said, oh, we need to simplify it a lot. Basically make it look like it's not even Solar. Like you don't know, you don't need to know it's Solar. And we came up with this UI. So like it's better graphic, better widgets. And like you have the timeline, looks like a real timeline. You have a bunch of colors. And the most important is if I go to the admin part, it's almost the same. We just have like the little button, edit button is clicked, and you have this drag and drop bar. And you just drag and drop widget. You don't need to know if it is a facet, a field, a date, a range. You just put facets. And same, each time you put a facet, you don't need to save. It's all in the front end. So you can play, interact in a few clicks. Because Solar facets are pretty smart, if I do some filtering on one facet, it's going to update all my widgets. And so I'm going to explain how we design it. That way you can give ideas. Then I will show a quick demo. So if I just show before Solar and Hue, and in the middle the standard REST API. So this time I have my web page on the right. And the logic is for each interaction on my page, the page is going to talk to Hue, and sometimes in some cases, Hue is also going to talk to Solar. For example, for doing a query, for inspecting a collection, getting the list of fields, the list of types. It's all done asynchronously. And this is probably the most important slide of the talk. It explains how we could make all the UI dynamic and how you can save, like persist, the dashboard template. The layout is like the blue page, like you can see it as like a 2D grid where you just put the widget. It's where you take a widget, you put it in a cell. The collection is all related to, I have a widget, like a slot. What is this widget? Is it like a field facet on the salary field? Is it a timeline on a date field? It's where we save all these IDs. These two are linked together. They have the same ID. And so now you have the dashboard. So imagine you can save it. But then there is no state saved yet. The state is like, I have my search dashboard. I'm going to type a query. So I have on the top, like my query search bar. And then you see the little orange rectangles. It's more, or I select this facet, I select this bar or this bar in this bar chart. And it's separated. That way, we can save each component individually, or we can share, and it's, we really separated all the logic from the presentation. So this is a quick example of the life cycle, how to add one of these little widgets. At the beginning, so we load the page, and it means we'll do some calls to Solr, in particular, like cluster state JSON to get the list of fields, their type. And also, if the collection has some dynamic fields, we can get it with Luke. Then it means when we drag a widget, we can present the list of fields. It's a bit small. And depending if it's a timeline or not a timeline, we'll show only the date fields, for example. And then where it's nice, so the user picked a field, and then we're going to query Solr. We'll do a stat on this field, and then we'll guess if it's a number or if it's a date, and we'll get the min and the max. So if you want to do like a range, for example, on a byte field, you have some byte from 0 to like 900,000 something, we'll get these two min and max value. We'll round them a bit to make them more pretty. And then we want 10 slots by default. We'll divide by 10 slots. And the user doesn't need to do anything. And it's the same with the date. We try to guess like the min, the max. You can still override it with the sliders, but by default, it will show you everything. And now we did like a byte facet, and we'll generate the Solr query. So a bit what you can do in the Solr admin UI. Solr is really cool because you can exclude some fields then in the filter queries later, meaning that even if I select the facet, like the second row in the facet, Solr will still return the value of all my slots. And then Solr returns like a default JSON. Instead of making it difficult in the front end, we are just augmenting it a little bit. For example, we have like the range, like 900,000. We don't have the start, we just have the start, not the end. So we just add it before sending that to the UI. So basically, the UI becomes just a template with no logic. And then you do this for all the type of widgets. It can be like a field or any type of facets, like field facet, range facets. And instead of printing like just the text, we plugged in some JavaScript libraries that will do like the heat maps, like a map, just based on the JSON. And then you keep, you repeat, you do it for like all the widgets. And then you can have like a complete dashboard. We have a few interesting features, like for people, like more enterprisey features, meaning you can connect to this UI, you can authenticate with like all the regular enterprise, like LDAP, SAML. Few come with many apps, but you can also disable them. You can share by link, like your final dashboard with a colleague on the current state, like if you have selected this facet on this type, this query. And we focus mostly on Solr Cloud, but we are compatible with any Solr because we just reuse the Solr API. A few security features. So we support Kerberos authentication. It means also Hue, like the web server runs as a certain user. But we use like the duas, so we give an extra parameter to Solr. on Solar will do the operations as this user, not as a web server. More recently, we have been doing a bunch for Sentry. For example, you can set who can see which collection or who can't see them. And then you can block like the Solar UI, like also block some query handles, like all the slash admin. And then you are sure that nobody can see everything, or like people, you can control who can see what. And then I have a demo. A few months ago, there was like a big buzz with a big data set of the taxi data from last year of New York. I put the links before in the bottom. It's pretty big. It's like maybe 10 gigabytes, like compressed. So when compressed, it would be like in the 40, 50. They have two data sets, like the trip, so where the taxi left with someone to somewhere else. And then also, I keep it for the end. It's like how much people tip the taxi. So in general, so I just logged in into Hue, and I'm going to upload like just a little bit of the data set. I'll just call it one. And because we use HDFS, we can still upload the data in one click. If you want to see the content of the file, it's regular CSV. Like the first line is the headers, and then you have the ID of the record, then the medallion of the taxi, the vendor ID, and then a bunch of latitude, longitude fields. We made a little indexer, so it's pretty easy. It works with like tiny bit of data, like a few megabytes. So you just point to the file, and we guess the types. And then it's going to create a Solar collection, so in Solar Cloud Mode, for your data set. And it will create the schema for you, and then upload all the data. So while it loads, it takes a few minutes, so I might jump to the dashboard. So when you create a new dashboard, you just edit it. And then, because we point to the Solar server, we have the list of collections, the list of cores. And here, I'm just going to pick up like the taxi collection. And that's it. I already a small UI. So on a bigger screen, it will be a bit longer. And I have already like a little UI where I can query data. For example, I think it's like vendor ID. I can put a value like CMT. So it's already functional. So I mean, it's pretty basic. So the most important part of the app is like, oh, you want to put a bit more data, rows, you just up it. You might want to just put the medallion, the passenger count, like trip distance, trip in seconds. It will just select these fields. And then you can do, most of the time you have an index, you don't know really how to explore it. Here it makes it easy because I will just say, I want to put a graph, a chart on some field, and I just try. Like, I can do exploration without really knowing the collection. And so most of some time, for example, I could say, oh, I want to, like we have the duration of the trip. So I just drag and drop the widget. So first, so we pick, like I just presented before, the min, the max. In the data set, there are some weird values that make the graph doesn't look good. So I'm just going to put 20 minutes of trip. And then it looks better. So that's for each trip, the duration of a trip. So you see it's roughly between like 200 seconds, like 3 minutes, 3, 7 minutes. We could also see it by just looking at the field, like trip in second. So we can pull in one click the statistics of the field. So Solar returns us the term in the index, and you get the stats, like the mean. So the mean is pretty big because if you have like, I forgot how much it was, but a really big data value, it will mess up your, it will mess it up. Coolus widget, I'm going to move it on the side. And I'm just going to plot my taxis. For example, I just put the marker. I will pick up the pickup latitude, the pickup longitude. As a label, I just put the ID. I can leave the edit mode. And then if I search for something or something else, it's going to update. For example, if I pick this taxi, I want to see where it was. I just put the ID. This one doesn't work. So the best part of the app is then you can keep adding facets. If I select, for example, like, oh, I want to know how many people are in the taxi in general. We have the passenger count. So it looks a bit small, but it goes to 6. But you see, most of the people are alone in the taxi. Some reason, some people were 0. So you can click on it. So it's probably bad data. And see, the trip is lasting like 6 seconds or like a few minutes. That's possibly bad data. You can do the same. For example, if you click on 4 people, if you have like some bad data set, there's a taxi that is somewhere, so it's probably a bad coordinate. You can just pick at it and see it easily. And when I click on any widget, so it shows you my selection. And it's going to update the time trip in seconds. So I could keep adding other widgets on the left. And then I'm going to do, what is it? Yeah, the coolest, one of the cooler widgets is like the timeline. So in the previous version, it was different. This time is much better. Same as before, I have some mean data that is not really meaningful. So it really starts only at the 25th. So I just put to the 25th. And then you can see that, oh, you have like a big spike. And if you look at it, you can look, if I go in 2013, in August, like the 31st is a Saturday, so I mean, it's not a big surprise, but more people are using the taxis. And all of this was made like purely in my browser. I didn't even save it. And you can point to any index. And now just to finish on the taxis, this one was interesting. So it's just the taxi fares. You can see that most of the time, people, they will spend like $7, $7, $9. But what is interesting is like the tips. Like, tips are really low. Like, it's like, I have like 26,000 records. I like 50,000 at zero. It's like 0%. I have a bit more, like 2,000 at 2%. If I look at the credit card, it's like the same distribution. But if I look at the cash, here I have absolutely zero tips. But it means, exactly. But it's still funny to see it like in a few clicks. And yeah, that was for the demo. And then, so if you miss the demo, we have also live demo online. It's other data sets. Usually we use Apache logs because they are cool for demoing. But the taxi was pretty good. The only problem with the data set is like anonymized, so you can't put. I had to use two collections, like the how much they paid on like the location. But you can't join them back for some reason. If not, it would have been cool. What's next? So we did more and more pivot facets. Right now, you can plot on a map, for example, what are the top elements by country, what is the top browser, for example, in US or China. But you can do it. Like, it's not plotted on a map. It's plotted on a heat map. Autocomplete, we just added it yesterday, actually. So you can, if you have a bunch of fields, you don't know to remember them. You can autocomplete them. The analytics range facets, so it's only in Helios search right now. But it could make, in the UI with them, we could do like a crazy distribution. For example, you could see the distribution of bytes if you are analyzing log data. Right now, we just count like one by record. But we could, instead of doing a distribution by count, we could just do a sum of the byte at this moment. So it would be way more realistic. And I show a little bit the mini indexer, which is cool for starting up. You don't need to set up anything. Just put a CSV, and you have your solar collection. And that's mostly this. So if you have any question, feel free to say them now or after, where I will hang around. So the question is, can we do geospatial search? So right now, I show the marker widget. You can't do a select and show like all the taxis that left from JFK. You can do in the query box, but you need to type manually, you know, like pickup location, latitude, like from to, and pickup location, longitude from to. So it's not there. But. Yes? So the question is, do users have different permissions to build the chart? So right now, it's all or nothing. If I am an admin, I can edit, move around widgets. The other interesting part is more with the Sentry, you can really see who can see which collection. So we're just doing a view. But right now, yeah, you can edit or not edit it. Like, it's not there, but it would be like Google Docs. We did it already from some other apps that you can share to a group or someone, something like this. It would be simpler. Cool. So I guess that's it. So I will stay around a bit. I will be around the Cloudera booth. And all of this is open source. You have the GitHub below. You have even more information on the blog. And feel free to contact us. Thanks a lot.